I'd like now to move into the main part of our program and to introduce Tom Chappell. Tom was recently appointed as Acting Chief Performance Officer at the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. In that role, he oversees the design and implementation of monitoring and evaluating systems CDC-wide and for many of CDC's programs and initiatives. Prior to that, he served as an internal expert consultant and technical resource on program evaluation and strategic planning for CDC's programs and partners, conducting numerous trainings, workshops, and individual consultations on planning and evaluation. He is a well-known and frequent national presenter and author on these topics. Tom is active nationally in the discipline of program evaluation, serving as convener for the American Evaluation Association's local affiliate collaborative and coordinator of their Summer Evaluation Institute. Tom has hailed from a few areas of the country. He received his BA from Johns Hopkins in Baltimore and his MA and MBA from the University of Minnesota. Many of us have learned a great deal of program evaluation from Tom, and I'm delighted that he's our presenter today. Tom?
Yes, I'm here. Great, thanks. Thanks for the introduction. Can I have the next slide? Here's the objectives for the day. I want to talk a little bit about program evaluation roadblocks. People have good aspirations, and then they run aground on these things I'm going to introduce today. I'm going to talk about our evaluation framework at CDC as a way to surmount roadblocks, but not because there's something special about our framework, but rather the approach of our framework is typical of applied evaluation approaches that try to get to use of findings. Now, the important thing is this is the first in a series of sessions, so I'm going to stay very high level, kind of a big overview of what's important about our framework, why it leads to better use of findings, understanding that a lot of what we'll talk about today will be dealt with in depth in coming sessions. Next slide. Okay, when I joined CDC, which was only a few years ago, a friend sent me this slide as a screensaver, and it's too big for a screensaver, but it's hanging over my desk, and it's from the myth of Sisyphus, that the gods condemned Sisyphus to endlessly roll a rock up a hill. Each time it would return to its starting place, the gods thought with some reason, next slide, there was no punishment more severe than eternally futile labor. And my friend sent it to me to inspire me, and there are probably a couple days a month where it inspires me, then there's a lot of the month where it really, really depresses the heck out of me, because like you, I'm sure you experience a sense that, my gosh, I'm dealing with the same problems I dealt with 3 years ago, 5 years ago. Why don't things get better? Why is it the stuff I do doesn't make a difference? But whether it inspires you or depresses you, it reminds you that planning, evaluation, performance measurement have a leg up on some other things we're told to do because we're naturally wired to want to have an impact. Given our choices, we really want to do the more impactful thing. So the question we'll address today is less how do I motivate people to do evaluation, because I think there's an internal motivation to do my work better, and more what is it about the way in which we currently preach it or do it that gets in the way of people activating this kind of impactful behavior they want to activate. So next slide. So my focus today is going to be on six or seven top roadblocks, the sort of speed bumps. People want to do good evaluation, but these are some places in which they tend to run into a ditch. Then we'll talk about how to surmount it. Okay, next slide. The first one, as you'll see, the slide deals with the definition we use of evaluation at CDC. In the late 90s, when our framework effort got underway, the problem we were trying to address wasn't so much that people didn't do evaluation, which of course was a problem, but more importantly, when they did it, it didn't make a difference. The findings didn't get used. There was no program improvement as a result of the time, effort, and suffering that went into program evaluation. So we first discerned that part of the issue was people defined evaluation too narrowly, and they tended to see it pretty much like research. So we purposefully looked around for the world's broadest definition of evaluation, and we wanted to define both evaluation and program much more broadly, so that everyone would see themselves as having something worth evaluating, and everyone would see evaluation not as a specific set of tools or techniques, but as sort of an orientation to your program, an idea of continuous reflection. So Michael Scriven's definition, evaluation is the systematic investigation of merit, worth, or significance of anything, okay? Well, other than the word systematic, it's what we do 24 hours a day. So that's what we wanted people to think of. No matter where you sit in the organization, you're doing something, you have an intended outcome, you can systematically think and reflect on, is it going well, is it going poorly? Okay. Likewise, program, we wanted to understand program more broadly. When I was a consultant for all those years, I probably did 100 pieces of work for CDC. And I would say maybe a dozen of those actually led to some achievable outcome. Because those programs evaluations, when people did program evaluation, it tended to be limited to people doing big training programs or community interventions or whatever. We wanted to broaden that. We wanted people who did recommendations and guidelines to think of themselves as a program. People who develop surveillance systems to think of that as a program. I'm doing something, I can name an intended outcome. Okay, next slide. The next roadblock was this idea of not understanding where evaluation fits in. Next slide. In large organizations, people tend to do planning, performance measurement, and evaluation, but they'll often do those in isolation from each other. All right? So as you can see, these things need to be united into what we call continuous quality improvement, or the CQI cycle. And what goes on and what makes it hard for planners, performance measurers, and evaluators is they tend to go into these things in a silo or categorical way, and so they never have a customer. So planners are often accused of what we call evidence-free planning. They'll come up with interventions or whatever based on what, custom, tradition, what they heard was a best practice. Well, what should be the main source planners deal with? Well, evaluators or evaluation data or performance measurement data. Likewise, evaluators are notorious for running around wildly trying to get someone to use their findings. Well, if we thought in the CQI way, we would automatically have a customer for those findings. Okay? So our evaluation framework from the start said we need to see planning, performance measurement, and evaluation as integrated, and we need to see evaluation as starting off with the idea of having a customer, having an intended user of findings, and directing the evaluation with that in mind. Next slide. The second problem we run into is what we call making the perfect the enemy of the good. If I told you today that the only way to be cardiovascularly fit was to run a marathon, for every person that would up their mileage to 26 miles, there'd be 90 people who would say, thank you for setting that bar and making it clear to me what I need to do. I can't meet that standard, and so consequently, I'll do nothing, all right? Well, evaluation faced the same sort of dilemma in the mid-90s, where we set the bar very much like research, and people thanked us for that clarity, but instead of getting better evaluations by setting the bar that high, we got less evaluation. People exited the process, that's not me, I don't have that expertise, I don't have those skills, I don't have the money to do that. Well, just as with cardiovascular fitness, if you can't run a marathon, it doesn't mean you're not going to do anything good by, you know, walking to work instead of driving, by taking the stairs instead of the elevator, by aerobically bowling or gardening or whatever it is you do in your life. Well, the same thing with evaluation. There is always something to learn when you're reflective about your program. And sometimes it can meet the high canons of research it needs to, but lots of times it doesn't. Okay, so next slide. So the second thing our framework tried to pitch was that there is always an evaluation worth doing. It's not always an outcome evaluation. It's not always about what we call causal attribution, but there's almost always something you can learn about your program. So the biggest mistake is doing nothing because you can only do a little. Cardiovascular fitness, nutrition, and evaluation, they all have that similarity. Even a little bit is going to yield some benefit. Next slide. There's no part of evaluation where this more comes to bear than in this area of measurement. And there's a tendency in evaluation. When I started doing this work with CDC a decade ago, we tended to evaluate what we could measure. So I would walk into a program, I'd say, what are we going to evaluate? They would give me 6, 7 very plausible questions. And I'd say, why are those your evaluation questions? The answer would invariably be because those are the things we can measure with validity, reliability, and accuracy. Now, there's nothing wrong with validity, reliability, and accuracy, but the difficulty is that in public health, the things we can measure with that level of rigor almost always are very, very upstream or proximal things. How many brochures, how many trainees, how many people showed up for our training, that sort of thing. Now, in the 80s, that worked. The government was, and our stakeholders were primarily interested in, you know, bang for the buck in terms of efficiency. Did we get a lot of product out there for the money I gave you? Did you spend my money and did you commingle it, all right? But as the 80s progressed into the 90s, increasingly we were asked these downstream questions, not just what did you do, but how has it mattered? What have you done for me lately? What have you done for public health, right? So next slide. So strong evaluation or strong utilization-focused evaluation, evaluation with a user in mind, worries less about what can be counted and more about what counts. Evaluation starts off by saying, what are the important things that need to be measured? And then says, can I measure them with enough rigor to meet the needs of this situation this time? And sometimes the answer is no, I really need to measure this in a way that looks very much like research. Well, then I don't do that intervention or I don't do that evaluation unless I have the resources to do it. But just as often, the question is more speculative. We can do sentinel data collection. We can do what we call triangulation, looking at the same thing from a lot of different angles and putting the puzzle together, right? The second reason that we worry about evaluating only what you can measure is, next slide, you get what you measure. So here's a quote from the, here's an excerpt from the New York Times from 1999. In Poland in the 1970s, furniture factories were rewarded based on pounds of product shipped. As a result, today Poles have the world's heaviest furniture. Okay. Now, the fancy name for this that we're all familiar with from education is called teaching to the test. And there's absolutely nothing wrong with teaching to the test, or you'll get what you measure, so long as you've decided that what you measure is that important thing. But just as often, setting measurement on what we can measure creates very strange distortions where people drive everything they do towards that measure. And if that measure is something unimportant or too proximal, then we don't get the public health impact that we're really looking for as programs. Nothing has advanced the evaluation cause in public health more than preaching this idea of intermediate outcomes. When I joined CDC, and when I started doing public health work, programs tended to have a fairly decent sense of the activities that they did, and they could generally name the health impact they were trying to achieve. But they lacked a lot of detail on what we call the program logic or the program theory, that vast landscape in the middle that determined why it is that my program will actually make a contribution to that downstream outcome. We call these intermediate outcomes, okay? And unfortunately and fortunately for public health, it's really where the action lies. A lot of the health impacts we look for at CDC are not going to be achieved in the current generation, all right? And so if one sits and thinks about only measuring that, you're almost committing yourself to failure. And if our answer is, well, then let me just measure my processes, then you're committing yourself to not meeting the needs of stakeholders who want to know, I thank you for telling me all the stuff you're doing. Is any of it working? Does any of it matter? So next slide. What intermediate outcomes do is help you unravel that storyline. I let this program out of the box with an idea that eventually it would make a contribution to this downstream destination. But what's the program logic? What's supposed to happen in the middle? So think of it as planting a garden, right? At the end of the day, I want to collect a certain number of tomatoes, and I sort of know what it takes to make that happen. But I don't wait 90 days and go out in the garden to see if my efforts work. I'm always thinking in real time about what are markers at 10 days, 20 days, 30 days that tell me I'm on the road to getting lots of tomatoes. And if I'm not meeting that marker in real time, then I take action immediately. This is one way that evaluation is distinguishable from sort of pure research. In a pure research model, I do an intervention. When the intervention's had a chance to work its magic, I detect whether or not I got the outcome, and I'm able, by doing a research model, to determine that my program achieved that outcome or it didn't. Now, if I achieve the outcome, that's great. I can say my program caused that outcome. If I didn't achieve the outcome, I'm sort of left holding the bag. I don't know why. I don't have a lot of detail about it. It's sort of this black box or an empty box between what I did and the outcome I was looking for. What evaluation does is unpack that black box with intermediate outcomes, and it says, there is a journey by which my program will lead to this ultimate destination, and it includes milestones at mile 5, 10, and 15 that look like this. And in real time, I'm going to look at those milestones, and if I'm not achieving them, I'm going to take action in real time and change what I'm doing. I was a soccer coach when my kid was 5 years old, which was a while ago now, and I had the world's best soccer program in the history of five-year-old soccerdom. I had snack schedules, drill schedules, nutrition tips. I had something I would hand out to parents every day when they came that said what we're going to do that day, what we were trying to achieve, how to reinforce the behavior at home. On the process side, this thing just sang poetically, but we never won a game. And the whole time I worked with that team, we never won a game, right? Now, had I been thinking in a research-oriented way, I would have had to give up for lost my entire approach to Soccerdom, even though I knew it to be the best in the history of Soccerdom. Thankfully, if I think about this in terms of intermediate outcomes, it's not hard to name, if you've ever coached five-year-old soccer players, what are the milestones and markers between how I do my program and this ultimate destination of actually winning games or having a winning season or being the champions. And for that team, it was, well, we got to start learning to pass the ball to each other, not to the other team. We got to learn to not cluster around the ball, but spread out. And then finally, and this is something we actually track, we got to spend more time down in the opponent's side of the field than huddled around our own net. Okay. Now, someone would say, I'm making that stuff up because I'm not winning games. And that's probably true 10%. But the reality is, I was puzzled by why we're not winning games. Am I achieving nothing? Is my program accomplishing nothing? And when you view it in terms of these intermediate outcomes, you can see that while we're not winning games, we're making that progress in the right direction. Okay, next slide. Our programs are the same way. Here's a famous cartoon most of you have probably seen before from Sidney Harris. Scientist has a step one, miracle occurs, step three, you know, and then final solution. And the caption says, I think you should be more explicit here in step two. Well, when I use logic modeling in particular, or I use this approach in strategic planning, invariably people will say, I'm glad we had this discussion because I see that our program has some big miracles, right? Miracles are not the part of our life that's going to be hard to achieve. Most of what we want to do in public health and human services would benefit from divine intervention. The miracle instead is that big gap. It's the big gap in the middle of our program logic that says, if I do training, technical assistance, funding, and partnerships, I will move the dial on morbidity and mortality due to asthma or diabetes or whatever, right? It's the miracle is that big space in the middle where we need to unravel why is it that that program would actually make a contribution in time to that downstream impact. Okay, and that's where intermediate outcomes lie, and that's really where the power of evaluation in public health lies, for two reasons. If I don't get that distal outcome, I want to be able to convince skeptics I'm making progress in the right direction. My parents probably were wondering by the end of the season, I wonder why we haven't won a single game. But I could point to and say, but look how the kids have grown, see how they passed each other, see how they now spend 50% of the game down by the other opponent's net. In diabetes, a program I had a lot of experience with in the mid-90s, you know, we were not making progress on that distal outcome. Demographics don't favor making real health impacts on diabetes if you're going to look at it as morbidity and mortality or secondary complications. The demographics are working against us. But when you look at intermediate outcomes, we're making great strides in things like timely receipt of foot exams, the number of people with diabetes who know how to self-manage their care. Now, are those excuses because we're not making those distal impacts? 10%. But 90% is to convince skeptics I'm still making progress in the right direction. And for me as a program to say every Monday when I show up from work, I'm not going to get that distal thing for a generation, but I do have my eye on some more proximal prize that I know contributes to that downstream thing and that I can kind of anchor my activity to right now. Okay? Next slide. For folks that do public health or human services, finding intermediate outcomes is usually fairly straightforward. It's very rare in the world we live in to be able to move a distal or a downstream or a long-term outcome directly solely because of our own efforts. Almost invariably, our efforts are trying to influence someone else to do something, and jointly, our efforts, their efforts, our ability to move them forward is what's going to get that downstream health impact or public health impact. So the intermediate outcomes are easy to find. What's that ultimate outcome I'm looking for? Who besides me needs to take action to achieve it? And here at CDC, for any sizable program, asthma, any or chronic disease, any of them, almost always I'm doing something at CDC that's supposed to move the consumer forward, something else to move the provider forward, something else to move policymakers forward. And in some magical interactive way, all of that leads downstream to getting my public health impact. Okay? Well, it's specifying that stuff that populates that miracle, that populates the program logic that lives in those intermediate outcomes. Okay? Next one. Next slide. This is the second thing, I think the second message that's been empowering as we think about evaluation in public health. That is, I had a friend in New Jersey. She happened to be in the diabetes program, but she could have been in almost any public health program. And after a presentation sort of like this, but at a conference, she came up and said, I have this problem. In New Jersey, the number of amputations of legs from people with diabetes has gone way down. But my problem is I can't hold my program responsible for that change. I can't make the case that my program was responsible for that change. Okay? Well, what she's doing is confusing what we call attribution and contribution. Next slide. In the late 80s, the Institute of Medicine came out with a book called The Future of Public Health, where they made the case that the biggest thing public health was doing wrong was seeing itself as a direct deliverer of services as instead of a mobilizer and a convener, etc. And what inspired that was a sense that the average roadmap for most public health problems looked pretty much like this little roadmap here, what we call network intervention. On the far right is an outcome we're looking for in the health system, some kind of health impact. But as you see, as you progress to the left, there are four organizations, or four entities in this case, that make contributions to it. Well, in the case of good old Agency A, there's a pretty straight line of sight. They do something that's going to make a direct impact on knocking over a domino on the far right. But down in B and C, and particularly poor Agency C, there's very little that they're going to do where their impact alone is going to make that outcome happen. The minute they progress past these early outputs, the chances that they're going to move that next domino really requires that their efforts be joined with the efforts of other folks. Okay? So what we say is that I can hold Agency C attributable, they have an attributable impact on those outputs, but after that, they need to be thinking about the contribution they make. The reason this is important is we would tackle the evaluation questions. So let me use my friend in New Jersey as an example. If I asked her, okay, so the big system outcome is less secondary complications, i.e. amputations, from people with diabetes, right? Why is that occurring? Well, in her case, she steps back and says, it's occurring because physicians in New Jersey are doing more timely and accurate foot exams. So they're early detecting problems. They're able to intervene before you lose the leg. Well, why are they doing that? Well, we step back one more. They're doing that because the insurance reimbursement climate has changed. People will fund these enhanced timely foot exams, and they'll fund assistance to help with them or whatever. Well, why has that changed? Because the standards of practice in our state for treatment of people with diabetes have changed. Well, why is that occurring? Because we formed a coalition of payers and providers, and we helped incent those standards of practice, and we helped make that that insurance reimbursement climate change. Well, you notice we had to step back four steps before we got to the first person singular or plural, I or we, right? So clearly this is a case where the case she needs to make is my efforts can be directly attributable to the creation of that coalition, but after that, I need to ask providers, was the coalition influential in changing your standards of practice? I need to ask insurance reimbursers, was the standards of practice that we incented responsible for changing the reimbursement environment? I need to ask physicians, are you doing more foot exams than you did before? Do you know how to do them better because of information and standards of practice we promulgated? Do you do more because the insurance reimbursement environment claim? So really what I'm making is this sort of chain of causation, circumstantial case, as opposed to what I do in research, which is look at New Jersey, look at New York, see what's happening with leg amputations in New Jersey and New York, and build a case that it must be my program because New York doesn't have a program like mine. Well, you know, it becomes much more problematic. Okay? The final roadblock, not asking who else cares. When I joined CDC, when I started doing work for CDC, as I said, over the years I was a consultant, I probably did 100 projects, and in 10 cases, I think I could say, because that project happened, a program got better, a policy got better, a procedure changed, okay? And that was not unlike the hit rate for the discipline as a whole, okay? And the question was not, God, were these bad evaluations? Were they uninfluential because they were bad? No. But the case was that we were methodically, analytically, and correctly looking at what were not the most salient questions. We made the assumption that if the question was important to us as CDC, or my client as CDC, it was the important question. And again, because so many of these interventions are networked, because we're often one or two or three arms length away from the people doing the frontline public health action, we need to think who matters for this intervention, who matters for making improvements in it in this program besides me, all right? And we call the fancy name for that is stakeholders. It's not a great word. It's an overused word, but it becomes fundamental to this idea of Don't bother with evaluation unless the findings are going to be used. Well, by whom? Used by the people who matter.